Thanks, students, for joining us. Good evening to all of you to this webinar on how to build your essay and personal statement. Before we start the session, I would like to introduce about TNI Career Counseling to you. We are a certified global admissions advisory venture founded by experienced and passionate individuals with top degrees in their respective fields. We do provide career aptitude tests, the assessment test, what we call, early advising, profile, and resume building. Test preparations and admission guidance for more than 10 countries and 1,200 plus global universities for undergraduate, master's, and executive MBA. Moving on, over the years, TCC has serviced 1,000 plus students with 99% satisfaction rate and helped students in securing $2 million in scholarship. The higher education guidance covers a blend of mentorship expertise and technology where we digitize the college applications experience using AI and ML. I would like to also talk about the services we cater to the college students and working professionals here. We do have a life coach and mentoring profile building program, college application guidance, summer school application guidance, test preparations like your GRE, GMAT, IELTS, and TOEFL. We do provide an extracurricular support to the student in order to build your resume and your profile building. Once you get an admit to the university, we also work with the family to secure loan, visa process and documentations, and foreign exchange. Moving on, focusing on just on the master's part, these are these top our students with their success stories. You can see Punappa, who is currently studying at London Business School for his MBA program with a score of 760 in GMAT. Bottom, you can see Nikunj. So today we're gonna focus a little bit about Nikunj's essay. So currently he graduated from Stanford University with master's in environmental engineering. So we're gonna talk about Nikunj's essay along the way when we finish the webinar. I would like to also introduce to our CEO and founder of TNI Career Counseling, Mr. Dhaval Mehta. Mr. Dhaval Mehta completed his undergrad from University of Michigan, Ann Arbor with a bachelor's in computer science and economics. He also completed his master's from Columbia University, and right now he has enrolled at an executive MBA at Cornell University. Moving on to our co-founder, Mr. Kevin Zinzani and Chirag Bhatt. Mr. Kevin Zinzani studied at University of Michigan for his bachelor's. So he went on to complete his master's at UC Irvine. And finally, he did his MBA from USC's Marshall School of Business. Mr. Chirag Bhatt is the mentor and director of TNI Career Counseling. He completed his bachelor's from IIT Chicago, and then he completed his master's from Stanford University. This is just a glance about our team's contact details. So I myself, Rahul Hazarika, senior student advisor and admissions for an applications associate. So if you have any questions related to admissions, you can reach out to me. My contact number is right there. You can take a screenshot of this screen at the moment. Okay, moving on. I would like to also talk briefly about our iGrad magazine. Our monthly magazine iGrad works like a liaison between the students, the universities, and the educators. As the voice of higher education, iGrad strives to bring invaluable expertise to students by making them aware of the education industry across the globe. It's a platform for three key components of the industry to interact, question, discuss, and decide. Be it our news and analysis from the education world or the opinions from the brightest mind in education global academia, we focus on helping students excel in their respective field and achieve their dreams. That is a little bit about our iGrad magazine. Now, just to start off with today's webinar, this is the agenda we have. I would like to invite my colleague Bosky to the platform. Bosky, over to you.
Thank you so much, Rahul. Hello, everyone. So we are going to discuss what are the essays and statements of purpose, why are they important, some common guidelines, tips and common mistakes to avoid. And also we will discuss some sample SOPs and diversity statement. Can we move on to next slide, please? So what is the SOP? It's a mandatory essay for all the students. It's a direct route to connect with the selection committee. And it also helps the panel analyze your aptitude and future aspirations. So your basically your scores and your mark sheets can give them information about your academics. But what about your personality? What about your achievements? What about your extracurricular activities or your social engagements? This is a window through which you can show them what you are, what your personality is, and how you are going to be a good alumni to their university. A well-written SOP is extremely critical to a student's application. Statement of purpose also gives you a chance to impress the admissions committee by presenting your profile strongly. It includes the traits that your academic reports and qualifications do not cover. Can we move on to the next slide? So a common format for SOP are, of course, introduction. So we have broken it up for you here. You start with the introduction. So it's not necessary that you have to give a very killer, some killer headline or a killer opening for your introduction. You try to be succinct and draw the reader in, but don't try to be gimmicky. If nothing comes to mind, just go straight to your point and why you chose this particular course. And then you can come to family and academic background, what you have done, what your family is about, from where do you come. Then you can go on to your professional experience, what you have done till now. I would request you to mute, please. What you have done till now, what your professional experience is, any skills related to any industry which you have gained. All relevant industry visits if you have done, your internships, projects, your dissertations, anything which is there. Any extracurricular activities which you have been involved in, like for example, charity work, or even your interest, your hobbies, your sports, community services. That also you have to include in that. Then why are you choosing this master's? Why are you choosing this course? And why are you choosing this university? And how this university, this course, is going to help you gain your career goals and your aspirations? You have to justify the choice of program, the university you're going to study, and why this country? And then eventually conclude your essay by saying how this program will help you do whatever you want to do in life. Can we move, please? So the introduction, of course, this is not just a self-introduction. You have to introduce your academic field of interest. Why are you interested in this field? And what makes it interesting? You can write how and why you got fascinated with it in the first place. And what do you want to do in this field? Then when you come back to your background, you can give academic information of either your school, whatever you have done in school or your college, or any industrial exposure you had, or any training you had, or any internship you had. Then you can, if you have any professional experience also, you actually should emphasize on that. Always include your extracurricular activities. It gives a holistic point of view to your selection committee. It helps them understand that you are not just mark sheets. You are actually a person who understands, who socializes, and who understands his and her society around. Then you have to tell why this course, to specify why you want to pursue this particular course. Discuss the course curriculum, how it is going to help you, how it is going to understand what you want to do in future, and explain your skills, which will help this course, if you're doing something in marketing, how this is going to help you into strategy, how it is going to help you connect with your clients. Is it B2B marketing you are interested in, or B2C marketing you're interested in? You can tell that, specify that. You should be specific about your career goals. Tell that in your essay that why this course is going to help you in your careers. Portray your long-term plans. Give them your short-term plans and tell them that why from this short-term plan what you want to do in your long-term. Sorry, can you go back? Thank you. And then, of course, doing a research about your university, your program, your country you are going there, and your faculty is very important. Specify features of university that attracts you. Why you are choosing this particular program? Why you are choosing this particular university? How the country you are going to will help you develop your personal self? How the exposure will help you realize your goals? And when you come to the conclusion, sum it up what you have written till now and tell them that how you are going to give back to the society as well. Can we move, please? So tips to improve SOPs. Plain language. You don't have to beautify it. Just keep strong vocabulary, but keep your language simple. Always include facts-based examples. Use a conversational tone. Do your program and university research well. Present a realistic career plan. You cannot say, okay, I want to do something in world peace. That would be very vague. Say what you want to do. Say if you want to go for environmental engineering, or say if you want to do NGO work. Do not use motivational quotes or vague facts. Address your weaknesses wherever possible, how you overcame those weaknesses. And then at the end, always proofread and get feedbacks from your counselors. Can we move, please? So the flow is very important in SOPs. Always remember that your SOPs, your essays are like your journey. Think it like this, that start writing in a sense that you have started your journey and how you have come here. So make the flow like that. Go back to your journey, go back to your school, go back to your interest, go back to your hobbies, go back to your skill sets. Think what you have achieved. Think what you want to achieve, at what particular age something fascinated you. Has that affected you in some way to choose this field? Think about that. Go back to your academics or your circle life, friend circle, social life, and think what fascinated you. What has made you this particular individual that you are? And that way you can take up the tone. You will find, mostly students find from their personal experience, they have written such great essays. So you can always write it like a story, how and why you are choosing this and how this fascinated you. And that way you can build up your essay. Always give it time. Do not write your SOPs just before submission. So if your submission is in July, I would suggest that you start preparing for it from Jan, Feb, or March. Always keep 3-4 months in advance, because you will start writing, you will have to rewrite, you will have to re-edit, you will keep on proofreading it, because you have to give something which shows what you are to the admission committee. This is how they are going to judge you. Do not copy and paste. Of course, plagiarism anywhere is serious offense, not just in university applications. Be original. I would suggest that what I said earlier also, just think it in a very practical sense what you want. Show them what you want to do, but not in vague terms. Tell them that what you want to do. If you want to do something in astrophysics, tell them why do you want to do that. Not just because you want to, you were fascinated by Star Trek. No, you cannot say that. You have to tell them how it affects you. Or if you want to do something in biotechnology, why you want to do that. Give specific answers. Write specific goals. Of course, you cannot use informal language and definitely avoid slangs. Stick to the word limit. The colleges do not appreciate if you skip the word limit. And do not provide any false information. Can we move on? So what schools are looking for in the SOPs? Mostly it's your research and professional interest. Be as specific as possible in discussing your interest. Show them that you are highly motivated. If you have achieved any leadership skills, show that how you got those skills. Tell them how something attracted you and how it changed you, how something changed your perception, how you are open-minded. Show those things in your SOP. How your background qualifies you to pursue a particular field and area of interest. You can always add professional experience, projects that you have worked on, or papers also you have written, or speeches that you have given, or any mentors you had. Even if your small article came in a newspaper, you can always mention that, how that helped you, how it motivated you, how it inspired you. Even your smaller achievements will play a good role in your SOPs. A proven track record of success. Emphasis on major accomplishments that highlight your ability to succeed in rigorous graduate school environment. How you have come here? Just describe your journey. What interests you in the program? Why it is a match for you? And what brings you to the table? What are you going to give to the university? So any university which is looking for students, just like you are looking for good universities, the universities are also actually looking for good alumni. So you have to understand this, that it is give and take. Show them why you stand apart from the crowd. Show them why you are different. And how will you show them? It's these essays which will help you show them that why you are extraordinary. Your passion show, tell them if you have done any voluntary work, tell them if you have helped any random person on street and how it affected you. Tell them how, if you have helped any underprivileged kids in school, if you have given extra classes to somebody, or for that matter, anything, if you see somebody on road and how you have helped them, it actually adds to your personality. It shows the committee, selection committee, that you are capable of something, you have future in something, and you will be an asset to their university. May assure them through your essays that you are an asset, not only to the society, but to the university, to the college, to the course itself. Can we move on? So importance of extracurricular activities, of course, extracurricular activities play major roles, especially in US. They look for a holistic approach. The US universities actually practice holistic admissions. So which means that while colleges look primarily at your grades and test scores, they are also concerned with the whole student and also consider your extracurricular activities and accomplishments. So in addition to grade and test scores, admissions officers are looking at a number of different things like extracurricular activities. These extracurricular activities, they are actually called soft factors, which they consider. They are intended to get students involved in clubs or initiatives that they are passionate about and develop skills like leadership, organization, and time management. Almost all universities have societies and clubs, and you can always take part. Tell that in your SOP, that why you are going to join this society, why you're going to join this club, how it is going to help you in your mission, in your goal, how these extracurricular activities are going to be a change, a personality changer for you in that university, in that program. So universities are looking for students who leave lasting impact on their campuses. They are looking to build a well-rounded class made of specialists in various fields. As I said, they are looking for good alumni as well. Activities like sports, art, music, volunteer work, all these things allow you, all the students, to engage in initiatives that actually bring you joy. So, of course, you're going abroad. Of course, you're going for higher education. But yes, you have to enjoy life as well. Go, you can always join these clubs. Show them why you are going there. what you are going to do this. It also helps their mental health and overall happiness. Can we move on? What is a diversity statement? So diversity statements are actually increasingly effective among the admissions faculty. A diversity statement is different from SOP in a sense that they ask for specific diverse, how your diversity is going to help the university. It shows whether candidates have skills, experience, and willingness to engage in campus diversity and equity efforts. So these statements are an opportunity for applicants to explain to a search committee the distinct experiences and commitment that they bring to the table. So every college wants a diverse, if a college actually is looking for diversity statement, it actually essentially means that they are very committed to inclusivity and supporting their diverse population. So they are looking for someone who would be supportive of that mission. And because you are going from India, you actually have seen so much diversity, you can pour that in your statement. It is actually a way that you can stand out in your SOPs, in your statements. We would actually now show you a sample of diversity statement here. Can you see that? Can we go down? Rahul, can we just, yes, thank you. This student of ours was working in an automobile company. So now when you read the first line here, just read the first line, "Sir, the combustor is dead." Right from the first paragraph, he has captured the diversity. He has come to the point. Look at the comparison he has made between local garage mechanic and an engineer. So see how he's saying that in India, at smaller to medium-sized auto repair companies, these mechanics, how they come from economically weaker backgrounds, but they actually know a lot about cars and repairing them. You must have seen that there are mechanics, they understand everything, but they may not know the names of the exact part. And he has said the same thing here. And while he was working, see, he has bring at that point also that I was working in Classic Redux, my current workplace. He has subtly, see how subtly he has put that he is still working. He is in a leadership position. So you have to understand this also, how you can subtly put your qualifications while you are writing it. So now he says, in my current workplace, the youngest car mechanic helped design a manual that has auto parts names written in two languages. This is diversity. Both of them have knowledge. Both of them have basic knowledge of what goes where in the engine. But the other guy who has studied only maybe till class 9th or 10th knows the part where it goes, but may not name the part. But this guy who knows the path, he knows everything. This is diversity. And then he says how this student, he saw this diversity and how this prompted him to introduce an education fund for employees that helped them support their children's education. So in the second paragraph itself, can we go a bit scroll up? Yeah. In the second paragraph itself, he says that bedrock of human ingenuity. Now he goes back to his journey. See, as I was telling you, you have to make your statement, your diversity statements, like a journey. Make it flow like a river. Just think about, start with your background, as I have already told you in the introduction. Go to your introduction, and after that, go to your background. Share with them what you have done till now, how you are growing up. See, he has given us, I experienced the advantages of diversity in many aspects, both at school, college, workplace. How India has diverse population. So he was studying in Catholic school, but he understood cultures, religions, and tradition from all different, wherever we are in our schools. Of course, if you're in Catholic school, we have people from all walks of life. And that's how he's telling that he took part in clubs, camping trips and voluntary work. And through this, he reached villages. In every para, you notice that he is actually defining diversity while putting his qualities seamlessly in the paras, in the whole flow. So now he's telling that he reached villages and underprivileged communities every semester and used to spend time mentoring young children. See, he has brought in his volunteering work here also. So during these trips, I was able to mentor a 10-year-old child and make a car from scratch. So, and how his creativity astounded him. Then again, he goes on to say that in junior college, he associated with humble, talented peers from different cultural and socio-economical backgrounds. Rahul, you'll have to scroll a bit, please. So, because you come from different walks of life and how financially also you are different, that's also he has brought in. So, see how he has said that on the growth of underprivileged students. So, during the competitions, he followed lower budgets. See, how financially, if you are financial constraints can also bring on your creativity and innovation. And that's how he's saying that he can do that as well. So he has managed to increase proficiency in multiple languages through Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati, aside from English. So this has allowed him to make personal connections at different areas. See, at AutoCar, he has again given his experience, his first full-time job. He trial tested 15 cars and most of the experts he interviewed were not highly educated automobile engineers, rather self-taught. He has again gone back to his basic anthology of how the diversity has affected his perception. So again, he's coming back that my journey thus far has made me open-minded, independent, confident, resilient, and adaptable. And now he is connecting the things, these skills, which he has gained through this, how he will be able to help or contribute in this university where he has applied. And then he again, of course, he has done his research pretty well. And he says that upon graduation, I would like to use this opportunity to further the interest of self-taught and all. So you can see that he goes on to share more experiences about his diverse culture and how these traits, these open-minded, independent, and confident he became, and how these traits would help him eligible for the college for which he's applying. This way, he has maintained the flow as well as incorporated everything which the college wanted or which he wanted to tell them, that he understands what he's doing. He already has some expertise in the field. He is experienced. He has worked with underprivileged people. He has done voluntary work. He has understood, he has also taken part in extracurricular activities. He's a club member, and how he wants to make a change in the society. Thank you, Rahul. I think we can go back to another statement of purpose now. So now we come to the statement of purpose written by one of our students. See how he goes straight to the point here. You don't have to go in loops. Sometimes, you know, you can start it with a generic thing, a generic line, and then go into detail. But sometimes it just works like this. See how he just went. Save the tigers was my mission in the sophomore year in high school, a way to restore faith in our wildlife. The second line itself, he said, look at the second line. He said that I raised this much amount for the Kids for Tiger program. The second line itself shows that this kid, this student, is a leader. He has done, he has already put that out to the selection committee that I have done this in my sophomore year itself. So, and he has given what recognition he got. He starts with his exemplary voluntary work right from his school days. He goes on to tell how he raised a certain amount of funds in a matter of few days, how he has inherent leadership qualities with his, see, he goes on to say that he sports skills, and he shares that he has also worked in to build a village pipeline in India for Indian villagers, while he has also worked on sustainable energy in Ghana. See, in the second paragraph, Rahul, can you just scroll, please? Just enough. Yeah, that's it. So he's saying apathy towards basic amenities made me contemplate my future in environmental engineering. He brought in that point that what he wants to do. After my senior year, I opted for research internship at a large solar power plant in the desert state of Rajasthan. Now he is giving you, telling this selection committee what he has done, his internships, and how he brought a change even in that internship. Fresh from this ground research, I began my undergraduate career with the other university. And he also worked with how he did courses where particularly water resource engineering and environmental engineering process he was able to do. And then he's saying that he again worked on sustainable development, which I told you that he, while he also had said about working in India, and in his, he analyzed possible solutions to replace the use of propane as cooking gas with more environmental friendly alternative for the people of Tamale, the fourth largest city in Ghana. So he has given you the statement of purpose in a way that he's writing about his journey. He's writing about his journey. He has gone to his background, and then he is telling the admission committee how he is, with all these career skills, how is going to, along with all these internships and jobs, how is he going to contribute to the university and in the future. See, these experiences, how it made him realize his interest in environmental engineering. But now he wants to learn more and wants to use that same knowledge in the application of much bigger goals. Rahul, can you scroll, please? Yeah, we can go to the next picture. So you can actually see that this SOP is actually just a journey, again, a journey of a student. What he wants, he has done is just roped in all the questions which were there in selector's head. He has put in everything in his journey and turned it into an essay. So that's how it shows that your essay should help universities understand that you are different. Show them through your essays like that. In the conclusion, always give why it is important for you to pursue this program, and why this university is important for you, and how you are going to contribute as an alumni also, and also as a responsible citizen. Thank you, Rahul, for sharing the screen. Can you go back to our slides? So do all, there are lots of FAQs, yeah? So some, actually one student asked me, how do SOPs or essay differ from masters or MBA? So I would just like to tell you that writing for MBA vis-a-vis student writing for MS is distinguished by the profile. So if a candidate is applying for MBA degree from a university abroad who has worked experience for at least 2 years or more, and this on the other hand, if that is not the case, for this may be a different program. So often students can and do apply for postgraduate degree with minimal or no experience, and it is not an eligibility criteria. But an MBA aspirant is a candidate who must have an experience. So this would effectively change the general theme of your essays when you are doing it. Again, some students had asked, when do we start shortlisting colleges and start drafting essays? Should GRE, GMAT be taken first? I would suggest it's always best practice to start drafting essays a year before and simultaneously shortlisting colleges. You can take GRE GMAT score is actually valid for 5 years, and hence you can apply for admissions to the universities of your choice within that time period also. It says that, yeah, of course, here we are saying, do all schools require SOP? So generally, most of the institutions abroad require an SOP to support your application, irrespective of your courses. What is the ideal length for an SOP? So unless the university has communicated its specific requirement, an SOP should be 800 to 1,000 words or 1.5 pages long. So I know that there are few universities which actually ask for particular characters or particular word count. I would actually suggest that you stick to those many characters and those many word counts. But if the university has given you a free choice, then you should stick to 1,000 words or 1.5 pages. Of course, that the font should not be more than 11, if I'm not wrong. Are there specific guidelines for formatting? No, there are no formatting guidelines. But yeah, I mean, if you are doing 1.5 page, it doesn't mean that you can write in font 14 and do it in 1.5 page. If you seek guidance related to an abroad university application process, so we do this actually. TNI Career Counseling will give you all the expert counseling services. And we also offer editorial services from SOPs and university essays, writing CVs and editing. And we also help you write LORs and all. If there is a feedback form, and in case you have any questions, please feel free. To put it on our chat box. Our content team helps students capture their entire journey well in the essays and letters of recommendation. So we give our guidance package also for US, UK, Canada, Australia, and other countries. Somebody has asked, how do SOPs for US, Canada, UK universities differ? So academic SOP content and idea remains the same, of course, across all the countries. It will differ in terms of word limit or university specific details or your program, whatever research you are doing or whatever interest is it. So it depends on university to university, but the basic idea would be same. Any other question? Okay. Somebody has asked, how do SOP or essays? That I have already told you. There is a feedback form. Please feel free to provide your feedback. No, we do not give SOP formats as such. You can sign up for the services because there is no template for writing a great or good SOP. It has to come through the student. And yes, we help you write them. Anything else? Any questions? We are here.
Students, we have another 5-7 minutes, so you can use the chat box to put any questions you have.
Okay, there is also a student has asked, when you start shortlisting, okay. So you can also take a diagnostic test first. You can actually check the raw initial scores. Preparation for GRE and shortlisting colleges should go actually parallel. So earliest deadline for fall is 2022 is December 1st for 2021. So if you are trying for that, you should invest at least 4 to 5 months to research about your colleges.
Yes, students are, if you want to get in touch with us, you can get in touch with me. I am Rahul Hazarika, your senior student advisor at TNI Career Counseling. My contact number is right in the screen. You can take a screenshot and you can note it down. If you want, you can get in touch with me. We can talk much more about that initial counseling session and how exactly we can position you for your master's application. Hi, Gayatri, you can contact me on this given number. We can talk much more about the initial counseling service we have.
Yes, yes, your courses and your actually your programs matter a lot. It's not just that you want to go into a university, you have to justify why you want to pursue a course or you want to go into that university. You definitely cannot say that you want to stay in that particular country, that's why you are pursuing that course. No, that will not help at all. So just say which course interests you, which program interests you, and how it will build your personality or how it will help you get better in life or achieve your goals. You cannot also ask for assistance, a financial assistance. No, you cannot do that. But yeah, we do. We are actually end-to-end a career counseling service. So we write from preparing you for these exams and helping you write SOPs and getting admissions, choosing universities. We do help you get, we also tell you about scholarships and all, and we also help you get loans if there is a requirement for you.
Any other questions you have, students? We have another 2 minutes.
So the next step, you are interested, you can actually get in touch with our counselors. Rahul has already given you his number. The connect, there is the ID also. Get in touch with us if you are interested for the further queries.
A question I had is this the right time? Because of course, you know, there's a lot of things in terms of, you know, which country and, you know, how, you know, the COVID situation is ongoing. So what is the recommendation overall in terms of, you know, country-wise and application? Because I know some of them talk about being test optional, but then are they test optional really? Or, you know, are these GMAT, GRE scores very important, you know, even this year? Because I hear that that's become more competitive.
Yes, so they are, so 5 year, you can, your GRE scores matter for 5 year. And different countries have come out with different notices, different rules for COVID, because of COVID. But you can apply and they are accepting students for the fall. And
right. So the question I was just trying to get at is also, you know, particularly from what I understand is US and UK seem to be, you know, fairly well vaccinated at this point. So most universities are asking students to get vaccinated before they come in, or the university will help you get vaccinated while you come in. So it seems that more of the hybrid or offline classes will also take place. And so a lot of those who were not able to apply last year are applying again this year. And so it seems that the number of applications are higher across the board. And it seems that these are competitive applications. So just trying to understand that, you know, how is that going to look in terms of applications as a cycle this year and going next? So that means students should start preparing sooner than later, right?
Yes, yes, definitely, definitely. Don't wait for any particular time. If you have decided to go, if it is there in your mind, then start preparing right now. Get in touch with whoever you think can help you. Get in touch with your counselors and start preparing your strategy, what you want to do. Because it is going to be competitive. Looking at India's educational infrastructure, it will be difficult hybrid education here right now, at least for a year, I would say. And UK.
So Moksha asked that what will be the right time to start the process for September 2022 intake. So Moksha, I think as we suggested that, you know, students should start early. So a typical student who want to study abroad for your master's, you need to have a combination of 10 universities in total in your list, right? Now researching about 10 universities list takes a lot of time depending upon what is your, you know, the tuition fees or the budget you have in mind. If you're looking for scholarships or funding such as, you know, research assistance or graduate assistance and so on, right? So there's a process to it. So if you're looking for September 2022 intake, you need to give at least 4 to 5 months to invest and do the research and, you know, come up with a 10 list of universities you want to apply.
Great. And what is the deadline for these, you know, universities in the US versus the UK, you know, for a September 22 intake?
So the earliest deadline right now I can see would be December 1st of this year, December 1st, 2021. Then it, the admission cycles ends at, I would say, January 15th. So December 1st is the earliest deadline we can see. So right now we are in the month of May.
Yeah, but then there are many of them still available who have deadlines which are later, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So what you're talking about is, are these more top universities, which are, you know, probably the top 25 universities or 30 in each one of these countries, which probably have early deadlines, you know, in December and January. And then some of the others have deadlines a little bit later as well.
That's correct.
And maybe because of COVID, they're sort of extending their deadlines.
That's correct.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much for joining us. If you have any queries, you can actually also follow us on Instagram and on LinkedIn and Facebook. That's the first one is our website. Thanks again.